Welcome to Learning English, a daily 30-minute program from the Voice of America. I'm Ashley Thompson.
And I'm Mario Ritter, Jr. This program is designed for English learners, so we speak a little slower and we use words and phrases, especially written, for people learning English. On today's program, Ana Mateo tells about a Brazilian artist whose subject is climate change. Brian Lynn has an unusual fish story from Cambodia. Then, learn more about the most common prepositions in English on everyday grammar. And finally, the lesson of the day. But first,
Brazilian artist and activist Mundano recently used some unusual substances to paint a picture on a building in Sao Paulo. The paint included materials such as ash and mud collected from natural disasters. Mundano created the mural to highlight the issue of climate change. Extreme weather events have been causing destruction across Brazil. The mural is very large, over 30 meters high, and 48 meters wide. The artist used ash from wildfires and mud from floods. His painting shows the gray remains of trees on a brown land so dry it is cracked. The picture represents the deforestation and severe drought in the Amazon rainforest. The mural also shows indigenous activist Alessandra Corape wearing a circle of flowers around her head. She holds a sign that says, "Stop the destruction. Hashtag keep your promise." The artist says those messages are directed to Cargill, a massive soybean producer based in the United States. Soy farming is one of the biggest causes of deforestation in the Amazon. Cargill says on its website that it will eliminate deforestation from its supply chain in Brazil, Argentina, and Uruguay by 2025. Mundano is seeking to hold the company accountable. "We are tired of being a country, a continent, where we and the natural resources we have here are exploited. We have to regenerate our planet instead of destroying it," the artist said in an interview. Cargill did not immediately answer a request for comment. Over the past few months, human-caused wildfires have severely damaged protected places in the Amazon area. The fires burned in parts of both the large Cerrado Savanna and the world's largest tropical wetland, the Pantanal. Smoke spread over a very large area and affected the air quality in some Brazilian cities. Drought has caused a critical situation nationwide. Weather predictions show that this will continue in much of the country through at least the rest of October. This information comes from CEMADIN, Brazil's Disaster Warning Center. On October 22nd, the depth of the Amazon's Negro River measured 12.46 meters, representing a small increase from 10 days earlier. At that time, the river was at its lowest point since measurements started 122 years ago. And this last reported measure is still about 6 meters below normal for the same date in earlier years. Rivers in Brazil's Amazon always rise and fall with its rainy and dry seasons. But the dry season this year has been much worse than usual. Earlier this year, a severe flood in the southern state of Rio Grande do Sul killed more than 180 people, affected over 2 million people, and destroyed city communities. Mundano, who calls himself an artivist, a combination of artist and activist, used mud from that flood to create the new mural. The activist group, Movement of People Affected by Dams, collected the materials. Mundano also used ashes from Brazil's fires in the Atlantic Forest, the Pantanal, and the Cerrado. He also used earth found in waste containers in Sao Paulo, and clay collected from the Savuer Muibu indigenous land in the Amazon, where Alessandra Corape is from. From floods to droughts, everything is connected, Mundano said recently in an Instagram post. He included a video showing the mural in Sao Paulo. The artist said it is his biggest mural ever. 3 years ago, he used ash from the Amazon to create a similar mural in Sao Paulo. That work showed a firefighter standing in deforested areas. It also showed a cow farm and trucks loaded with cut trees. I'm Ana Mateo.
Researchers say a large fish that was thought to have disappeared from Asia's Mekong River has been seen in the waterway in recent years. The fish is called a giant salmon carp. A recent study detailed the most recent sightings of the fish. The lead writer of that study said the fish was seen at least three times between 2020 and 2023. The predatory fish can grow to more than 1 meter in length and has an identifiable yellow spot surrounding its large eyes. The Mekong River is Southeast Asia's longest river. It passes through China, Laos, Thailand, Myanmar, Cambodia, and Vietnam. About 60 million people depend on the river for food and survival. It is also an important environment for numerous river creatures. The leader of the research was Chiana Chut. He is with the Inland Fisheries Research and Development Institute in Phnom Penh, Cambodia. The giant salmon carp is like a symbol of the Mekong region, Chiana recently told the Associated Press. He was the co-writer with other researchers of a study announcing the findings in the publication Biological Conservation. Chiana said researchers had believed that the last confirmed sighting of the fish in the Mekong was in 2005. But since 2017, biologists following the movements of migratory fish in Cambodia developed relationships with local fishing communities. They asked people in the communities to inform them of any unusual sightings. That process led to the finding that three giant salmon carp were identified in the Mekong River and a neighboring waterway in Cambodia between 2020 and 2023. Bunyeth Chan is a researcher at Cambodia's Sve Ryung University. He helped lead the research. Bunyeth told the AP, "I was really surprised and excited to see the real fish for the first time." Researchers say the sightings give them new hope for the future of the species. Another name used for the species is ghost fish. "This rediscovery is very exciting, positive news," said Zeb Hogan. He is a fish biologist at the University of Nevada, Reno, who was part of the research team. But the problems the fish experience also demonstrate the dangers facing all migratory species in the Mekong. The huge river faces industrial pollution and overfishing, among other problems. Brian Eiler is director of the Southeast Asia Program at the Stimson Center in Washington, D.C. He was not involved in the research. Eiler said one issue is that more than 700 dams are built along the river and neighboring waterways. In addition, there are very few workable fish passages that help species avoid obstructions. The Greater Mekong area includes Vietnam, Cambodia, Laos, Thailand, and Myanmar. The researchers said they hope that cooperation with local communities in Thailand and Laos will permit them to confirm whether the fish also still swims in other parts of the Mekong. I'm Brian Lin.
When English speakers talk about time and place, there are three little words that often come up: in, on, and at. These common words are prepositions that show a relationship between two words in a sentence. Some prepositions are rather easy for English learners to understand. Behind, over, under, next to, etc. But these little two-letter prepositions seem to create confusion. Here are a few rules to help you understand when to use in, on, and at in a sentence. For describing time and place, the prepositions in, on, and at go from general to specific.
Let's start by looking at how we talk about time. English speakers use in to refer to a general, longer period of time, such as months, years, decades, or centuries. For example, we say in April, in 2015, or in the 21st century. Moving to shorter, more specific periods of time, we use on to talk about particular days, dates, and holidays. You may hear, "I went to work on Monday," or "Let's have a picnic on Memorial Day." For the most specific times, and for holidays without the word day, we use at. That means you will hear, "Meet me at midnight," or "The flowers are in bloom at Easter time."
When English speakers refer to a place, we use in for the largest or most general places. You can say that VOA is located in Washington, D.C. And for the best food, try the restaurants in Chinatown. For more specific places, like certain streets, we use the preposition on. You may know that President Barack Obama lives on Pennsylvania Avenue in Washington, D.C. Finally, we get to the most specific places. For exact addresses or intersections, we use the preposition at. If I invited you to visit us here at VOA, I would say, come to my office at 330 Independence Avenue. To be exact, it's at the corner of Independence and 3rd Street.
In English, though, there's always an exception to the rule. When talking about transportation, things get a little hard to understand. We use on for public vehicles, like buses or trains, but also for smaller ones, like a bicycle. I rode there on my bicycle. However, you ride in a car. Still, it helps to know that English prepositions do have some rules. Following the general to specific rule should help you most of the time. I'm Jill Robbins.
And I'm Ashley Thompson. And now, words in this story. Specific, adjective, clearly and exactly presented or stated. Precise or exact. Intersection, noun, the place where two or more streets meet or cross each other.
Now it's your turn. What helps you to remember the prepositions in English? Do you have any grammar tips you'd like to share? Write to us in the comments section.
You are listening to the VOA Learning English podcast. Today we have Jill with us to discuss everyday grammar. Welcome, Jill. On today's show, you talk about three little words that cause trouble for English learners.
That's right, Mario. And they aren't the famous three little words, I love you, that some may think of. They are what we use to talk about time and place, in, on, and at.
I know there are a lot of prepositions in English. Are these the most common ones?
There are from 100 to 150 prepositions in English, and these are in the top 10.
Really? Do you know them?
Sure. They are in, on, at, for, with, by, to, from, into, and about. The most common ones for time and location are at, on, in, and by.
Okay. What can help learners know which one to use?
I think the best way is to think about going from general to specific. For time periods, for example, we use in for longer periods, then on for shorter periods like days, and at for a specific time.
Although we can't show it here, I've seen a pyramid diagram that teachers use to show this rule.
Yes, you can see the broader part of the pyramid is in, and moving down to a narrower point is the preposition at.
Okay, thanks for joining us today, Jill.
It's always my pleasure. I hope this article is helpful to those who get confused by these prepositions.
Hello, my name is Anna Mateo.
My name is Andrew Smith.
And I'm Jill Robbins.
You're listening to The Lesson of the Day on the Learning English podcast. Welcome to the part of the show where we help you do more with our video series, Let's Learn English. This series shows Anna Mateo in her work and life in Washington, D.C.
In Lesson 46, Anna discovers she has a little problem when she sees her friend Marcia. Listen and see if you can guess what the problem is.
Have a nice day at work, Marcia.
You too, Anna. Oh, wait. Do you have pen and paper I can borrow?
Of course.
We are meeting at this restaurant tonight.
What is happening tonight?
Today is my birthday. We are celebrating at 7 p.m. tonight. Did you forget?
Sorry, Marcia. I gotta go. See you later.
Don't forget! Tonight, 7 p.m.
Listeners, do you know what the problem is? Anna gets worried and then leaves quickly when she learns that it is Marcia's birthday. So the problem is, Anna has forgotten Marcia's birthday. Next, we see Anna at her desk at work.
I forgot Marcia's birthday, and I don't get my paycheck until next week. I know. I'll make her a gift. I'll just have to borrow a couple of things. Amelia, may I borrow your stapler?
Sure. I can lend you my stapler, Anna. But please return it. It's my favorite stapler.
When you watch the video, you will see that Amelia keeps her stapler, an office tool for connecting pieces of paper, in a special box. Amelia acts like her stapler is a very valuable item, like a piece of expensive jewelry or a special family photo.
Well, some people really do like their office supplies.
That's true. Now, let's look at the language Anna and Amelia use. They use two very useful verbs, but these verbs sometimes cause confusion for people learning English. The verbs are borrow and lend.
Anna needs to borrow Amelia's stapler. That means she wants to use Amelia's stapler and then give it back to her.
Amelia gives Anna the stapler to use, but she expects Anna to return it to her. When you let someone use something, but expect them to return it back to you, you lend it to them.
And don't forget to use the correct prepositions. We borrow from someone, and we lend to someone.
Remember, the borrower receives the item, and the lender shares or loans the item.
Notice that Anna says,
Amelia, may I borrow your stapler?
The expression, may I, is the polite way to ask when we want to borrow something.
Next in the Lesson 46 video, Anna collects more office supplies. She collects paper clips, small pieces of paper, tape, elastic rubber bands, and more. And she borrows scissors, used for cutting, from Jonathan. What do you think she's going to make with all of those things? Let's listen.
Happy birthday, Marcia!
Thanks, Anna. I love birthday gifts. Anna, it is interesting. What is it?
Well, I know you love hats, and you need office supplies. So, this is your own office supply hat.
Wow, that is a lot of office supplies.
Many people loaned or shared their supplies with me. Some people really love their office supplies. It has paper, pens, tape, erasers, rubber bands, binder clips, paper clips, and a light.
What is the balloon for?
The balloon will help your friends find you. Let's try it. You get a seat in the restaurant, I will find you. Sometimes all the money in the world can't buy the perfect gift. Till next time!
It's true. Sometimes the best gifts are the ones we make ourselves. Anna has made Marcia a unique hat. That's spelled U-N-I-Q-U-E. And means that it is very special and not like any others.
In English, we call a unique item a one of a kind, meaning there are no others that are the same as it.
Yes, and this certainly is a one of a kind hat. Anna took a small round container and connected all the office supplies to it. So now Marcia can walk around with a hat of office supplies.
And a red balloon on top, too.
There's always something silly going on with Anna. But when we listen to Anna talk about office supplies, we can hear a very common aspect of American pronunciation. She uses many words that end in the letter R, such as paper, rubber, eraser, and binder.
And on the Learning English website, in Lesson 46 of Let's Learn English, you can find a pronunciation video that explains this. Let's listen to it.
In this lesson, you hear Anna using many words that end in the letter R.
It has paper, pens, tape, erasers, rubber bands, binder clips, paper clips, and a light.
One difference between British and American English is the sound of er at the end of a word.
In American English, that sound is a strong er, as in stapler. In British English, the sound is closer to ah, stapler.
It has paper, pens, tape, erasers, rubber bands, binder clips, paper clips, and a light.
Now that Anna has made her special hat, she needs to return the scissors to Jonathan and the stapler to Amelia.
Yes, and she especially needs to give Amelia her stapler back. I think Amelia would be very upset if that didn't happen. You know, this reminds me of an expression that I learned when I was in Japan. It was, only a fool loans a neighbor his scissors.
Well, you know, that reminds me, there is a famous expression in English.
Wait, is that by the famous British playwright William Shakespeare?
Yes, and I think you know what I'm about to say.
I think I do.
In Shakespeare's famous play, Hamlet, a man is saying goodbye to his son. And he gives his son some advice. And one of the things he says is, neither a borrower nor a lender be, for loan oft loses both itself and friend, and borrowing dulls the edge of husbandry.
That's some fancy English. But what it means is, if you lend someone money, you might not get it back. And so you might lose your friendship with the person who borrowed your money. And if you borrow too much money, then you might not keep your house or family in good financial condition. And that's because you will owe too much money.
I guess that is good advice. But, Jill, I was going to ask you, do you have $20 I could borrow to take a taxi home? I forgot my wallet today.
Well, I feel pretty good about our friendship, so for today at least, I'm going to go against Shakespeare's advice and be a lender.
I'm glad you are a lender B, and I shall give thy money back to thee.
Now, you're just using fancy English for the fun of it. Don't worry, I trust you. Well, listeners, we trust that you enjoyed this lesson of the day on the Learning English podcast. Thanks for listening.
Remember that you can also find us on YouTube, Facebook, and Instagram. Thanks again for listening. I'm Andrew Smith.
And I'm Jill Robbins.
And that's our program for today. Join us again tomorrow to keep learning English through stories from around the world. I'm Ashley Thompson.
And I'm Mario Ritter Jr.